Although scientific models may not be as beautiful as the ones you see in perfume advertisements, they are incredibly useful. They are also incredibly diverse, from Einstein's famous equation to this representation of an atom to a model organism like a lab rat. In many cases, scientists can agree on a model that is most accurate. For example, the plum pudding model of an atom has given way to Rutherford's model, then Bohr's, then Schrödinger and Heisenberg's. All this was achieved through experimentation. In evolutionary biology, however, one cannot go back in time to observe speciation, or compress all of evolutionary history into a short enough time for observation to be carried out in a reasonably timely fashion. Fortunately, we do know enough about how evolution happens to model it with reasonable accuracy. Many different models are available, and the most appropriate ones can be chosen depending on application. In fact, some phylogenists lean so strongly towards one model that they may even refuse to talk to those who prefer another model. In general, models represent simplified versions of complicated reality, whether by abstracting unnecessary details or idealizing situations. Models of phylogenetic trees, that is to say, trees that show evolutionary relationships, are based on theory, and the degree to which knowledge is applied to these models depends on their utility. Given a list of organisms and their genetic sequences, it is possible to construct a phylogenetic tree in three main steps. First, align the sequences. Next, estimate the tree. Finally, root it. Each of these steps has its own set of options for modeling. Sequence alignment has two main options, global or local. Tree estimation can be done using distance-based or character-based methods. Rooting options include using an outgroup or a molecular clock approach. As you can tell, given that there are so many different options, these models are limiting cases that can only be applied to specific situations. Each option has its own set of assumptions that are relevant only to a subset of organisms. For example, in sequence alignment, the Jeukes-Kenton model of nucleotide substitution simplifies matters by assuming that each substitution has an identical rate of occurrence. This is in fact untrue, as A to C substitutions occur less frequently than A to G substitutions. In tree estimation, the unweighted paired group method with arithmetic mean, or UPGMA model, assumes that there is uniform mutation rate over time for all organisms. The same goes for the molecular clock approach to rooting. This is once again untrue, as organisms with shorter generation lengths tend to accumulate mutations more quickly. However, as this assumption is sufficient to approximate relative evolutionary relationships, a more accurate model is sometimes unnecessary. Limiting as they may be, though, these different models generally converge upon very similar phylogenetic trees, even if the details might differ. In the end, these are all only models that attempt to discover true evolutionary relationships between organisms by making various assumptions about genetic changes. Due to the relatively minimal impact of horizontal gene transfer, it is generally not considered in most models. However, horizontal gene transfer plays an incredibly important part in the development of eukaryotes through the acquisition of mitochondria. Normal evolutionary trees only ever branch out without crossing over or converging. Trees that take into account all instances of horizontal gene transfer, especially in bacteria, would become too complicated for many purposes. Other phenomena that cause most phylogenetic tree models to break down include hybridization and genetic recombination. Although it may be possible to construct a model that takes into account all of these phenomena, there is a trade-off involved in terms of complexity and computational requirement. The choice of model to use depends on the type of organisms involved, as well as the purpose of the model. For example, local alignments are preferred for dissimilar sequences from organisms that are distantly related. Ultimately, it must be kept in mind that these are merely models, subject to the assumptions and theories that guide their construction. As much as they try to approximate true evolutionary relationships, confirmation is difficult as we cannot look into the past except through bits and pieces of evidence that have been preserved, often in very poor condition. These models must not be regarded as the be-all and end-all of evolutionary relationships, as theories can still be improved on and these models modified accordingly.